You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts, LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, Teachr, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, JameselJay of
Podcast episode 134. Welcome back, bro.
Thanks, man. I'm a little nutty still from the fucking drive, man. You spend that much time by yourself. Oh, and I also drove the entire way without any music on, just complete silence.
Like a crazy person.
Yeah, maybe one.
Did you at least play like fucking, I don't know what kind of card games you play. You know, I'm slug bug for yourself. I mean,
hit myself, smack myself in the face every time I see a little Volkswagen bug. Yeah.
I mean,
smash you know, bug, red bug.
there is a little bit of a feeling of accomplishment if you can actually go that long without any, you know, you're kind of stuck with your thoughts though. Right. You know, and then.
Well, here's the way it always happens. The first 5 hours is there's just a lot of and then usually it's about after 5 hours then things just start blending in.
When you get to Arizona, pretty much.
Yeah, past Phoenix. Once I'm past Phoenix, you know, and this time I took off at night, so I was driving in the dark, you know, through there, and yeah, it was it became, you know, like just finally like a meditative state basically. And I leave the music off. Just because it represents time, you know, anytime you listen to music, you're like, okay, I just heard a song. Okay. There's another song. I must've listened to, I don't know, 4 or 5 songs. That's a certain amount of time. Well, that causes me to keep track of time, you know? And when I just leave the music off and I'm just, you know, there's nothing there, then, you know, it's just easier to lose track of time. And it makes the time go by quicker.
I see.
And it doesn't mean that there's necessarily complete silence. Sometimes I'm, you know, saying some stupid shit or just, you know, yeah, some crazy shit comes out of my mouth sometimes. Just, I don't know what the fuck or whatever. But anyway, this was the first time that I actually drove the entire almost 30 hours without stopping and sleeping. And it was only because right about where I normally stop or where I was starting to get tired, it was there in Texas, this fucking asshole cut me off so bad that if I didn't, like, cut my wheel and slam on my brakes, I would have run into him. And, yeah, oh, and this guy, oh, what an asshole. This son of a bitch. This was just another one of them. This wasn't the one that almost got run off the road, though. This guy, he managed to stay in front of me for like a couple of hours, and he wasn't going slow. He was going fast, you know, but he just, you know, whenever it was time to go past him, he just managed to get in front of me because he wanted to go faster, too. And I was forced to look at that horrible throwy of POX, POX, and just really analyze it, you know, just really, really analyzing, you know, and coming up with, you know, maybe the guy was, it's shitty because maybe the truck was moving. Maybe cops were shooting at him while he was trying to do it. That's the only way I would accept that horrible of a fucking throwy. It's so bad that it made me want to stop somewhere and practice doing throwies, you know, and I don't do throwies. I'm not a throwy guy, you know, I don't mind doing a throwy. I think they're kind of fun to do and everything, but I'm not normally known for doing fucking throwies, but that shit made me want to practice doing throwies just because it was so shitty, and I had to look at it for so long.
Yeah. I
became more angry at the truck driver for having left it on his truck. Like, if that was my truck, as soon as I would have seen that shit, I would have been painting right the fuck over it or cleaning it the fuck off, like, before I even got on the road. It's so bad, that throwing. It's just so bad. I'm not trying to be discouraging to Pox, you know. I was a toy also, you know, at one point. We're all toys. When you're getting started, you know, and you suck, you're a toy. It's okay, but keep practicing, okay? Keep practicing and you know, maybe not the Rust-Oleum with the stock cap, you know. Maybe spend a little bit of money and get you, a Montana or, you know, Maybe our new fucking our new spray paint line that we got, you know, maybe go get you some go paint. All right. You know, and practice, get you some nice tips, some different tips, you know, some different effects and everything and go for it. Okay. Pox, don't settle for that shit that you left on the back of that truck. Okay. That's horrible. But I'm glad you got up and, you know, I'm sure it looked better in your mind when you're doing it than it did. I hope you didn't take a picture of it and post it. And if you did, I hope your friends gave you a hard time about it. Okay. So anyway, so right about when I was getting sleepy, this one guy almost ran me off the road and, you know, before I would have that guy, I would have chased his ass down, run him off the road, beat the hell out of him, stab him to death or something. But because of the meditating, I went through that thought process in my mind and didn't do it. You know what I mean? Like I'm able to see that it's not a good thing to do. And then the second time, this asshole just pulled right. He didn't want to get out of the way. It looked like he was passing an 18-wheel truck, and he was in a pretty big truck himself, probably like a 45-foot truck, you know, big high back and everything. And about halfway through passing that 18-wheel truck, I'm coming up behind him, you know, and I didn't get right up on his ass, wasn't being a dick about it or anything, but, you know, I come right up on him, and I sit back a little bit, and then about halfway through, he decides, fuck it. I'm good here. I'm just going to chill right fucking here next to this 18-wheeler doing 10 miles an hour under the speed limit. And then he just sat there and sat there and sat there. And I'm just like the blood starting to boil. And I'm like, you motherfucking, like the tiredness that was coming in was getting replaced with adrenaline. And there was a guy behind me that was pissed as well. He was like right on my ass and everything. And once that 18-wheeler finally realized that this dude had decided just to sit there, he went ahead and sped up. And enough to where I could get in and go past him. And, oh, man, I wanted to so bad cut that son of a bitch off and make him swerve or something like that. But the meditation allowed me to go past and move on without doing that. However, I did get some enjoyment in watching this guy behind me that was 10 times more angry than I was. The dude was just stalling. This dude pulled over in front of him so bad that I thought that dude's truck was going to flip. That thing swerved and was fishtailing and shit. Because I was watching the whole thing in my rearview mirror, and I did get a smile on my face, you know, and I was not, you know, too upset that the dude did that because I honestly did want to do it. But yeah, so I drove the entire almost 30 hours without stopping and sleeping.
So statistically speaking, that for sure is more dangerous than getting on a plane and almost contracting COVID, right? Statistically speaking, right?
Yeah, but here's the thing. You know what? If you're safe and you're not in a hurry or whatever, there is a way of doing it that's a lot safer than what I did. You know, yeah. And I used to be a lot worse. You know, I used to get to where I would just nod off like continuously and almost fall asleep driving for a little while before I'd pull over and stop. But you know, now I got the wife and kids and everything. I promise myself as soon as I come close to make, you know, nodding off, like one nod, I stop and I pull over. Now, you know, other than that, you got deer along the road that you might run into, especially in Texas. You don't want to be driving through Texas at night. And if you do, stay behind an 18-wheel truck in the slow lane and you're good to go. You know, because if a deer does jump out, most likely that 18-wheeler is going to clear him out. And you know, you're not going to hit the deer.
Are there people that actually go pick up the deer? I mean, like in the middle of fucking nowhere, like
and eat them. I don't know.
I was thinking about you know how when they have like cops clear the road when there's like a fucking mattress in the middle of the road.
I'm sure they have, they probably have like the road, service. I've seen trucks, like road service trucks or whatever. I'm sure that probably scary, part of their job is to, you know, if there's parts that are still on there or whatever, just clearing everything off. But
that's
dude,
scary though, man.
You get hit by a deer, man. That's like hitting a little car. Hitting a little car, and
it happened to my friend before, yeah, and it totaled the little Japanese car that she drove, so. shit's no joke, man. They'll just pop out of you like fucking like nowhere, man. You know what I mean? So, but
or they'll be standing in the. Here's the problem. What happens? What almost happened to me when I was driving back after driving to Florida the last time. I wasn't coming down I-10. I was coming from Waco because I went through and went to the surfing ranch. But what was the problem is that as I was driving along, there were deer sitting out in the road. Not sitting, but like standing in the middle of the road, just standing there. So what happens if there's no activity for a while, there's no cars coming by for a while, then they'll just walk right out and just stand there. So that's why it's better to, you know, to be on interstates or to be behind a big truck or something like that. Because if there has been an activity and that big truck is in front of you, like I said, it's not going to stop an 18-wheel truck.
Just follow pox, man. Just follow pox and you'll be okay.
Follow pox and it'll lead the fucking way.
So, okay, I know you – what did you do when you were in Florida, man? I mean, hang out with your
pops? Not much, dude. Not fucking much because it rained every single day I was there this time.
Well, we were supposed to do some podcasts, but, you know.
It was storming. It stormed, dude. Yeah. Like, the power goes out there. I mean, it's some gnarly fucking – like, I hadn't seen a storm like that in a long fucking time, man.
Yeah, so to the audience, sorry, guys. You know, like I said, we do this when we can, and it wasn't a chance for Teachr to do it. We tried to do it on the road, but we're back this week, so feels good to be back, man. Now, I saw that you got a mullet when you were in Florida. You got to just, like, get back into the scene, man, or what?
Yeah, you know, look at that. A fucking perfect little mullet there. You know, that's I actually did have a mullet up until art school. I think by the time I was done second year or so of art school, I trimmed it back because I had started doing some modeling or whatever. But, yeah, dude, I was total fucking mullet for
– But did you tell people that you're a business in the front and party in the back? I'm just curious.
Oh, no. No. No, that wasn't even a thing back then. You know what I mean? It was just what your hair looked like from if you were from that area, you know? And
the dude was
cutting my hair for the first – It was actually the same guy that had cut it the last time.
He's like, you want a mullet, 6 months. Right?
No, he was, you know, he knew exactly what I had wanted. So he did one side, then he did the other side. And he was getting ready to do the back and top. And then I was like, I look like I got a mullet right now, don't I? And he's like, yeah, pretty much. I took my phone. I'm like,
nice.
So,
and so wait, on the way back though, I saw you met up with some of our friends, man. I thought that was pretty awesome.
Yeah. Smack and TV Head actually hung out with them, and they took me around, and we hit a few spots in Austin, which is pretty cool. You know, just to be able to. That's one of the things that this podcast does for us. You know what I mean? I just shot a DM out to Smack and said, "Hey, man, I'm gonna be rolling in town. You know, tomorrow afternoon." I was in Houston when I hit him up. He's like, awesome, man. Hit us up. You feel like going out and, you know, hitting some pieces? And I'm like, sure, man, why not? And so we went and hit it like a bunch of vandals.
Hell yeah.
And then after I hung out with them, I went and met up with Good Luck Buddha. And we, you know, and like I said, I would have hung out and partied with you know, both Smack and TV Head and Good Luck Buddha, but you know, it's the COVID and we all wearing masks and you know, trying to spend as little time as we can, you know, near each other. So after we were done pasting up, I was like, yeah, I should probably get going. Went and met up with Good Luck Buddha right outside the Sino Cafe, and you know, just had a coffee and social distance visit and exchanged some art, and then got back on the road. Dropped off another Cheshire cat there on the outskirts of Austin. Yeah, right there you go, right next to the fire hydrant there, near the art garage. Right there in the background is this place called the Art Garage, and got back on the road. Drove to Las Cruces, New Mexico, and was starting to get a little bit tired. So I was like, you know, I'm going to go ahead and call it an evening. Got up the next morning and actually had these two Teach Peace crosses they were still in my truck from, you know, whatever. And so I thought I'd try to be a little funny, and I found a spot to leave them. And instead of leaving them as crosses, I left them as X's. So I said it was Dos X's for Las Cruces.
Nice, man. So in the last episode, actually, well, in the podcast you're about to hear, that we forgot to go over this question. They asked us if you get, like, people picking them up, man. So I just – do people usually pick them up pretty fast, the stuff that you leave?
Sometimes they do, yeah. I mean, the first cat that I put out back near in northwest Florida, that was picked up, I think, like the next day. The one that I left right outside of Austin, I don't know. You know, a lot of times people don't let me know when they picked them up. There was a while where I was putting out these dogs, and you know, it's kind of a scavenger hunt to some degree, but I don't make you guess too much. You know, I take a picture and a video and show exactly where it is. I tell people, okay, like, you know, this particular day at this time, I'm going to be putting up the video to show where it is. And I've had people pick them up as quickly as within 5 minutes of posting where they were. Just because they were, you know, happened to be right near where they were or whatever, or they called a friend of theirs to go pick the piece up for them. Mm. But it's, you know, it's a nice way to kind of give back. You know, I usually do that after I've sold a couple of pieces and, you know, made a good chunk of money. And it's kind of like, you know, giving back or giving to people who maybe can't necessarily afford, to buy, pieces from me. You know, at the same time, maybe, you know, just motivating someone to get off their ass and go look for something, you know, instead of just sit at home.
Yeah. You know, it's part of I always love that aspect that you do too, man. Cause it's part of like the, public art, interactive street art thing. You know, there's always like interaction between the artists and, the public. You know, you just leave them on the street and people pick them up. It's part of the whole street art game, man. I love that, dude.
So yeah, actually, TV Head in Houston, I think it's TV Head ATX on Instagram. He does that as well. When we were out getting up, I saw that he had left a canvas behind for someone to come pick up.
That's so awesome, man. We got to get TV Head on, dude. I think his work is really cool, man. So
yeah, oh yeah, absolutely. And he's very similar to me, actually. Kind of a tall guy into house remodeling a little bit, and
he didn't show up with the TV on his head though, right? Not this time though, right?
No.
okay, because every single time I've seen him online, he has the TV on his head, dude. So you know what I mean. But you know, super cool.
He's guy. Very consistent, but he's a really cool guy too. Really, really nice guy. Really cool. I enjoyed their company. I wish I could have, you know, had time to hang out and stay there the night and party with these guys. They're great guys.
Well, the cool thing is that, you know, the other founder of LA Street Art Gallery, Mitchell Dumlau, actually has officially moved to Austin now. So now we have more heads in Austin, man. So,
oh, shit, man. I didn't know that. I would have hit him up when I was there.
Shit, I didn't even get to see. No, I mean, he just got there today, actually, man.
So, oh, shit. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, then.
You know, well, what's cool is, like, you know, now we have, like, these little, like, enclaves that of communities that, you know, we've reached out to on the show. And in the future, when events come back, man, it'll be cool to, you know, go to these show. We got to go to these.
Let's talk about our next event right quick.
Okay.
With the paint.
Yeah. Okay. So.
The paint. Show the paint.
The paint, man. The paint. I'm very excited because
it only took us 3 years. That's all. And you know what? Just so you people know, if you ever have aspirations of starting your own paint line, good luck. Because it's a little bit like the Fight Club, you know, like you can't just all of a sudden say, here, you know, we're going to do this. You got to, you know, get people that are actually going to work with you. And you know, if you're not going to be ordering thousands and thousands of cans, good luck, because, you know, these guys are used to working with people that make big orders and stuff like that. And we're just getting started off and everything, and they're kind of like, I don't know if we want this new player in the game or not. Let's let them sit there and sweat it out for a bit. And 3 years they made us wait. You know, Fight Club, what, you got to sit outside 3 or 4 days? Huh?
Well, how it is, man. I mean, at the end of the day is, you know, there's very few factories that actually make spray paint in this country. And we wanted to get something that's American made, and we wanted to get the OGs of the OGs, right? Because our brand is a Go Paint. And if you flip it around, it's OG spray paint, right? Basically. And it's made by Edward Seymour of Seymour Spray Paint, the original inventor of spray paint. Edward Seymour didn't make it himself, but his company did, basically, you know? And so we got the original company that makes spray paint to manufacture our brand. And, you know, we our label will be out pretty soon at a location near you. But we were thinking, everybody has already, a lot of people have already reached out. I put it on the story today. I said, hey, Go Spray Paint is here, finally. You know what I mean? And then we got a lot of messages saying, like, hey, I want to try a can. How do I get a can? You know, where do I buy it? And I was like, you know
what? We ain't going to be driving this shit around. Fuck that.
First of all, spray paint is very hard to ship, and it's very expensive because this shit is flammable and explosive. You know what I mean? So it's not very easy.
Shipping to little bombs around, little Molotov cocktails.
It's true. Yeah, exactly. So we were thinking right
they
now.
They wouldn't let me use them in China because they called them a fucking weapon.
That's true. So we were thinking, well, Teach, you know, does some painting, and then I do some DJing, and then if we were to just get together some place in a COVID-friendly outdoor place, and maybe just
maybe the old Fame Yard there across from Fairfax High School.
Yeah, we got to ask.
Maybe we go there.
We got to talk about Meg Zaney about that, right? She's a curator of that place. And basically
somewhere near there, though, probably.
Yeah, so. Somewhere near, you know, Melrose area. And then we're basically just going to have a table, and Teach is going to do some painting, and then I'm going to be doing some DJing. And if you want a can, all you got to do is show that you follow the page, Paint the Town Podcast, LA Street Gallery, Teachr, and basically come out and show that, you know, you listen to the podcast, you're part of the community. And we'll give you a free can, man. And everybody uses black.
Maybe a couple cans. Maybe not just one can, because it's not, you know, worth the trip for just one can.
Okay.
If you can show us, hey, you know what? You know, I'm going to be doing a piece with it or whatever. Maybe we'll give you more than. Maybe we'll give you a few cans.
Yeah. We're gonna basically get some samples, and I figure that's the easiest way. And we'll make it a day out of it. Maybe we'll have some food or something like that. But you know.
And you know what? It's COVID safe because we're going to be outdoors. Everyone's going to be wearing a fucking mask. Stay spread out and everything, and you know. And, dude, I went through this whole trip. I drove to Florida. You know, I went into restaurants to pick up food with my dad, wearing masks and everything. And I managed to go this whole distance, went and saw the guys in Austin, did all this stuff, and got my test back, and I'm, you know, negative. So it's possible to do a lot of traveling, be around a lot of people, do a lot of things, and still be safe. So,
yeah. I mean, in other states, it's totally different, right? The things are opened up and, like,
right? Dude, Florida is fucking crazy. The schools are open. Kids are in school.
Yeah.
A friend of mine is a couple of friends of mine are teachers at the high school that is in my area. And they're like, yeah, they're getting ready to send another big, you know, cluster of kids home. Because they got the COVID. Oh. Like, I don't see this being sustainable right now. It's kind of a little bit crazy.
Interesting. Yeah.
And there's anti-maskers, you know, students walking around that won't even wear a mask. It's fucked up, dude. It's some fucked up shit there. I was careful as hell. Everywhere I went with my dad, you know, he's got like 3 or 4 masks now that he keeps in his car. And, you know, we just go get the food at the restaurant and take it home, which sucks because I've always tried to get my dad to be a little bit more social and go out, and here we are having to do the exact fucking opposite.
Let me ask you, does your dad have anybody that had COVID that he knows at his age?
No.
Okay.
He's a little bit of a hermit at this point. He goes to church, you know, on Sunday, but... You know, he doesn't talk to hardly anyone, says hi to people, I'm sure, but, you know, doesn't sit there and have any long conversations with anybody or anything like that. And, but he's stoked, man. He's now know where I get my ability to be a hermit from. You know what I mean? He's happy to be by himself. He loves having this caregiver that I hooked up for him to come by Tuesdays and Thursdays. It's beautiful lady named Laura is really, really nice. And they go downstairs and play some pool on the pool table and go out for a walk. And he just likes her because she's very pretty and she's nice.
That's awesome, man. Well, dude, I mean, you know, this week is kind of a special week. We did a pot. We did someone else's podcast, actually. Yeah. We did the One Love Art Sessions, man. And that's
those are cool guys, man.
Crespo,
definitely check them out if you guys want to hear another podcast, kind of similar to ours, but a little bit more organized, a little bit more professional, I would say. But I dig these guys. They're no one's dying, trying to line up to do this job. You know what I mean? It's not that easy. So I always have respect for you guys doing this, but they're pretty damn good with it too. So
first of all, they listen to the show, man. And whenever I hear that someone listens to the show, man, I always feel honored. Sometimes some of my friends tell me, "Oh yeah, I'll listen to this one show." I'm like, "You listen to the show, man? Holy shit. You're my friend, dude. I need to watch what I fucking say."
That's a true friend. Yeah.
Or maybe it's just actually kind of entertaining, hopefully, right? You know what I mean? But, but what I'm
like
saying,
a car wreck?
But, One Love Art Sessions, man, like I can tell that these two dudes are like both like deep dudes, man. And they like to have like deep conversations about art.
Yes, other topics absolutely. As well
too. Every single episode, they basically name the episode. They name it a topic or something like that. And then they basically, they talk about it. So for example, our episode was called West Coast. Yeah. So, I mean, first of all, I feel honored that they selected us as the representatives of the West Coast, man. But, some of the other episodes that they have are like completion, obstacles, accountability, everyday art room, things like that, man. So, I mean, it's a little bit different from our show. I think it's a little bit more structured and they probably don't goof off as much as we do. I mean, or maybe they do. I don't know. But
I think they do too.
Have a good time. They have a good time. Yeah. They're just more professional than us. Maybe. You know what I mean? They have like cool graphic images for all their stuff.
Consistent. I would say they're more consistent than we are.
So they're on episode like 17, I think. Right.
Yeah,
so
I think we're episode 17.
So I know we haven't had a show in a couple weeks, man. And, sorry about that, teachers. Been gone.
Oh, dude, the storms. You don't want to, like, we would have been sitting here talking, then all of a sudden it would just be like, but storms in Florida do not fuck around. Anyone who is listening who is in Florida, you know what the fuck I'm talking about, especially Bradley or, Augie. You know what the hell I'm talking about, don't you? You're down there near St. Petersburg, the lightning capital of the world is what it's referred to. I lived down in that area for a while, and it is, dude. You want to talk about a light show. And yeah, anytime this shit's going on, you don't want to be anywhere near any electrical stuff and having something like this going on. No way.
Yeah, definitely. So on that podcast, man, we got into a lot of cool topics. I mean, we got into kind of a little bit about our backgrounds for their audience, man. I think we started talking about like the Super Bowl at some point. We started talking about,
I thought it was also cool just to, keep with the theme of West Coast. They, asked us what it was that, the location of California has done for us as far as our, careers and our desires and stuff like that. I thought that was an interesting question.
Yeah, actually.
And I pretty much told them that, for me, California pretty much kicked me right in the balls, doubled me over, and then as I doubled over and went around the backside and stuck its boot straight up my ass and just kicked the fuck out of me. But is kind of what I needed, I guess, to help develop and evolve. So, sometimes you need to get your ass kicked a little bit in order to develop.
And without further ado, guys, here is the One Love Art Sessions.
Hello, hello, everyone, and welcome to episode, 17. Episode 17 of the One Love Art Sessions. Our first of 2021. So yeah. We're coming in on a bang. Let's go. So let's start with a little bit of housekeeping. As always, if you like what you hear, please do us a favor and subscribe. It says It's an easy and free way to support us, or you can go ahead and give us those 5 stars on Apple Podcasts or review us on any podcast platform you are listening to us on currently. Also, please go to Instagram and follow us at One Love Art Sessions, spelled out One Love Art Sessions. Repost and like our content. A like and repost is free, but is absolutely priceless to us. As always, I'm JameselJay, artist, designer, avid game show network watcher. I am an artist and designer, and I've been working in the New York City area for a very, very long time, and I'm currently working as a product design manager. I guess that would be my official title. And if you've been with us before, you know I am only one half of the One Love Art Sessions. I cannot do this alone. So everyone, please say hello to my partner in crime, my co-host, the Carol to my Baskins, the one and only Crespo.
What's up, One Love community? I'm Crespo, family man, artist, and educator, and the other half of love. Thanks for joining us. If this is your first time here, Jay and I put together a virtual series called the One Love Art Sessions. Our goal is to bring talent community together for creativity, heart-to-heart discussions, and chill vibes. For this episode, we're traveling to the West Coast to cut it up and maybe one day break bread with our brothers from another podcast, James and Teachr One. James Shen is a DJ, producer, founder of the LA Street Gallery. I like this. I had to add this. He quit his cush corporate job, sold his house, and started a mission to prove that Chinese Americans can make a name in the international DJ and art scene. Teachr One is a veteran artist skilled in a variety of mediums, most notably stencil work, or at least that's what captures my attention. Teachr works along a unique continuum of the street and studio, creating emotionally evocative images enlivened by deep palettes and rich textures. The better to advance narratives and bring more detail into focus for his citywide audience. And together they are the hosts of the Paint the Town podcast. That's at PTTP show on IG if you want to go follow them right now before we start this conversation. So fellas, tell us, we try our best to introduce our guests, but sometimes we always miss something. So Teachr, tell us a little more about yourself.
Oh man, I can definitely tell that I didn't write my introduction. It sounded really nice. So much better than and eloquent than I could have said of myself, you know, but that's a typical artist, right?
That is.
Well, let's see. Before I was a street artist, I was always an artist. Through high school and everything, my high school art teacher was this beautiful lady with an amazing body. And she told me about, you know, instead of having to go to college, I could actually go to an art school, you know, like where I didn't have to learn all the other shit stuff. Excuse me.
Nah, it's cool. It's cool.
We're good. Okay. Yeah. I didn't know if we're just
what level we're at here. My art teacher with an incredible body, but I'm gonna apologize for cursing. Well, you're already way down the rabbit hole, man.
Hey, you gotta understand. This is like a way more like formal thing than like what we do. We're like you know, we kind of just hang out on Zoom and sometimes we get high too and just talk. But yeah, go ahead, Teach.
It's all good.
That's about it. Yeah. I basically, you know, realize I'm partially dyslexic, so okay. I thought that I was just stupid when I was younger, you know, because I'm trying hard and harder than all the other kids and they seem to be doing better than me. And so I'm like, you know what? I seem to be pretty good at this art stuff. Maybe I should go for that. And here's this art teacher that enlightened me upon this, you know, this art school. And I was like, man, I just wanted to do all kinds of artwork to impress her. And man, one of her favorite things that she would ever do, like, you know, this is for all the guys, maybe even some of the girls, who knows. You know, whenever she would come around to look at whatever you're working on, she would bend over and put her hands on the desk, and she would always wear these low cut, you know, blouses or dresses or whatever. Dude, at a young age, you know, like I can't apologize for what my mind did back then. I'm just merely informing you.
No, mine was Miss Williams, man. Mine was Miss Williams. Like, I still remember my English teacher. She was so hot, dude. I had the same experience. But I didn't go into English, though. But anyway, sorry.
You almost did, though. I bet you considered that shit.
I did. I thought about it. It got me out of my ESL class, you know what I mean? Shit.
Mrs. Brogdon was very inspiring and helped to inspire me and got me off to art school, which I ended up getting a bachelor's degree of fine arts, which, you know, these days I really wouldn't recommend that unless you're going to go into teaching, you know, or some specific, you know, administration job where you need a you know, master's degree and you need to get a, you know, bachelor's degree along the way or something like that, because I ended up doing, illustrations, and, you know, for some couple of magazines, and then I quit doing that because you have to be good at nagging people, you know, constantly yelling, "Hey man, I'm still in town, man. Look what I just did. Hey man, you're still around. Check me out." You know? And it's like, I'm not good at doing that. So, you know, I was doing commission paintings of, actually started doing show horses, like Arabs and half Arabs.
Okay.
Ended up meeting some of the richest people in the world and doing paintings for them. Okay. And, then it was really not a whole lot went on until the Pentagon thing came around. 2001, 9/11 had just happened. And I decided to do a series of paintings, the first series of paintings I'd ever done. Before that, I was just trying to sell my shit.
Yeah.
And so, I did 12 paintings because I figured I'd put together a calendar because you can reach more people with a calendar, you know? And so I figured, well, to help make a story about the whole thing, my dad made some nice frames for each one of these paintings I did, had 10 of the world's religious symbols hidden in each painting. Hmm. Basic message, you know what? You want to get along, look at the big picture, you start picking out all these little symbols, this is where the problems lie. Anyway, so I figured I made some easels. I figured I'd take them to each crash site from 9/11, put them up on easels, take a photo with the, you know, crash site in the background to help put together a nice calendar. That's how I ended up at the Pentagon. Mm. And I had gotten a permit to shoot them in front of the Capitol building. And when I was getting that permit from the police department in the Capitol building, and I was telling them about, man, I've been trying to reach the Pentagon and this, that, and the other. Like, oh, dude, you're going to have this permit. Just show them this permit. You have what kind of camera? I'm just, you know, this little camera. Like, oh, dude, you'll be fine. Go on over there. So after I put my paintings up in front of the Capitol building, took a photo, I took them down and drove them over to the Pentagon. Drove around, found a nice little grassy spot that had, you know, big enough to where you had the Pentagon in the background, and there's cops and motorcycles all over the place. So went to the one closest to me and just to let him know, hey, you know, here's what I'm doing over here. And he goes, no, you're not. I'm like, well, I was just over at the Capitol building and they let me set up over there. I got a permit. He goes, well, let me see your permit. I'm like, well, here's my permit. And he's like, yeah, well, this is for the Capitol building. Okay. This is the Pentagon. So I'm like, okay, you saved the day, man. I don't know what they'd do without you.
Your whole career been about people saying like, nah, you can't paint here, and then you're like, well, I got this permit. I'm just wondering, I'm noticing an actual parallel when you were a street artist.
Dude, I never really looked at it that way.
He's still using the same permit.
I envision him getting pulled over for speeding and just handing over the permit for the Capitol. Well, I have this permit, officer. And he's like, no, this is not going to help you.
For a while, I don't know if those numbers are still the same, but I had some phone numbers of the, I guess the guy in the manager's office in the Pentagon and the guy in the commercial division in the Pentagon. And they're two phone numbers, you know, I could legitimately say, hey, you call this number and they'll validate me. Yeah. So, so what happened was this guy gave me a number to call. And so I called that number and I got an answer machine. I'm like, you know, left a message, hey, you know, whatever, want to set some paintings up, and there's my number. Told the guy, yeah, it's just an answering machine. He goes, that's about all I can do for you. Sorry. I'm like, man, I drove up from Florida to get that shot. Luckily, I had some family in New Jersey, so I went and visited them and everything. Then I got back out to California. This guy calls me up.
Of course.
And says, hey, can't let you set the paintings up inside the Pentagon, but if you'd like to set up and work on a painting, I'm sorry. If you'd like to put the paintings inside the Pentagon, we'll do that. And I'm like, dude, that seems infinitely more complex. Like, all I want to do is set them up outside and take a picture. It wouldn't take 20 minutes. You guys don't have to do anything, but you want an, okay, no, you're going to allow me to put my paintings inside the Pentagon. Okay. Now,
of course,
a friend of mine from back home, I used to airbrush T-shirts in a little tourist area. And he was like, dude, why don't you sit up next to your paintings in the Pentagon, like airbrush T-shirts and sell them? And I don't know if you can tell by that accent, but I come from a redneck area in Florida. But I was like, dude, they're not going to let me airbrush in the fucking Pentagon. Okay. So, but I was like, you know what? If they're going to let me sit there and view up my paintings and no one's coming around, I'm going to get bored. You know, I'm going to call and see if they'll let me work on a painting. And the guy, I didn't find this out until later, the original guy that I talked to was on vacation when I called to get permission to do this. And the guy's like, yeah, you're going to be right outside the building manager's office between quarters one and two, you know, second floor near the A-ring. No problem, you know, because he thought this other guy had gotten an NASA permit for me to be there.
Huh.
So come to the day I'm supposed to be there, in there, the first day I'm staying at a hotel room, and they're like, yeah, we got a problem. You have to wait till tomorrow.
Huh.
I'm like, okay.
Just keep stacking.
And so the next day I go in, I'm sitting outside the metro entrance for about an hour, and finally this guy comes out and gets me, Rick Dawkins, brings me in, and we're sitting in the office, and there's the associate building manager, the deputy building manager, and two other higher-ups, and dude, there was something going on. And like, I'm just sitting on the couch watching everything, and finally one guy was close enough to me, I didn't feel like I was intruding, and I'm like, hey man, what's going on? And he's like, you.
Yeah, what's going on?
I'm like, all these guys are in here because of me. He goes, well, you know, didn't have the right permit for you. You know, we got to figure out what to do with you. You know, we got in here, you got your paintings and stuff. You're not supposed to be here. So, you know, we got to figure out what we're doing here. And I'm like, okay, I'll just sit back down then, chill. You let me know, I'm right here. They let me set up. The third day, this guy happened to come back from his vacation. He just got reprimanded big time. Every day I went into the metro entrance, I'd have to call in. That day he got on the phone, like, I don't know what you're doing in here. It's just supposed to be the paintings. And I'm like, whoa. Jeremy Cuthbertson, ooh, he was not happy with me. I come in, get all set up and everything. He comes back out and he's like, there's the original paperwork. See, just the paintings. Not you. You can stay here the rest of the day, but then that's it. It's just the paintings. I'm like, okay. But dude, it had already, like, the first day went down, and second day, like, people were bringing me coffee and donuts and thanking me for being there and everything. Like, it went over 10 times better than I ever thought it would have.
Oh, man.
And people kept stopping by, and they'd be like, what are you trying to sell the paintings? What's going on? No, no, no. I just want to give you guys something else to look at. You know, I'm here working on the painting. I'll be working on it until I'm done. And they're like, how did you get in here? I'm like, well, building management. Well, the second week was different. All of a sudden, all those people that I told, including some two-star generals, went in and were like, dude, you guys are awesome. Thanks for getting this guy in here, man. I'm going to, you know, recommend you guys for, you know, all kinds uh-huh. of, you know, rewards and shit, you know. So that following week, I was like the prince of the Pentagon. They called me the resident artist of the Pentagon.
Hey, check that out.
Wow.
That's awesome. I ended up going back like 7 times. I'm still supposed to put together some kind of program where they have either one or two stations where for a week at a time, you know, like during business hours when most of the people are in the Pentagon, you come in, you sit there, you work on your painting, you got some of your shit around you. Yeah. And dude, it just, I started there and then I started going to other places, military bases, but then it expanded to police departments, fire departments, courthouse complex, city hall. Mm. And then I realized, you know what? I'm basically turning art into a community service in a way, because I'm taking art to the people who are doing, you know, service to the community.
Yeah.
And it has much more of an effect when they get to see it happening, you know, when they get to see it developing, as opposed to just bringing in some paintings and just sitting them there. When they get to see the artist there, and when I start, I'm there with a blank canvas, maybe a sketch down, and then I just start painting, you know, there's always an awkward conversation. There always was. My hometown in Fort Walton Beach, Florida, I went to the police department. I'm like, hey, you know, wanted to see about working on a painting in here, you know, possibly like that area right over there, that empty area. Is anything ever good? No. Now, what, you want to do a mural on the wall? No. This is actually it's a project that started in the Pentagon. Oh, well, okay. Yeah, you just let me know and we'll get that. do you have a phone number we can call to, you know? And I'm like, here you go. And they would call it, and they're like, okay, yeah, sure, no problem, man, just get you set up in here. And they didn't know, they would never understand exactly what I was talking about until once I was there. So once I was there, they're like, oh my god, are you gonna be here later, and can I see this like when you're done? I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna be here all week until I am done with it.
Well, that kind of,
yeah, go ahead, James.
I was saying that kind of like was Teachr's previous art career before he became a street artist.
Before I became a vandal.
Yeah, I mean, but you know, it's like kind of like public.
Got arrested and spent the night in jail.
Yeah, public Cheers. Art and community service, you know what I mean, and things like that. So, you know, I connected with Teachr when he became a street artist, actually. I think, like,
in 2010, 11, they were taking budget cuts from the education, right? And in California. So basically Teachr started doing some graffiti and he started doing the Teachr moniker. And you came up with that around 2011, right, Teach?
Yeah, actually it was the end of 2010.
Okay.
And I moved out to California and didn't like the way they do the propositions out here with voting. It's like they take a thing and then they shove in some, and it's like you gotta fuck one thing in order to get something else. You know, and I'm like, you know, and when I first came out here, I saw some graffiti. I'm like, man, I want to do that, but I couldn't think of anything. So when this came up, I'm like, I'm gonna do graffiti, but I'm gonna use it as an activism. And since my wife was the one that showed me the article in the newspaper, she's from Europe. She's amazing, very, very intelligent. You know, kind of blaming it on her. So she's like, yeah, okay, I'll support you. And like I said, when I did get arrested, she came and bailed me out. So,
well,
It was right around then that James did guys got in touch with me and asked if I'd be down to let them do an interview. They were putting together some interviews.
But LA Street got it.
LA Street Art Gallery.
All right, so hold on, Teachr, because now at this point, before we get too deep into LA Street Gallery, I do want to know, James, how you got all wrapped up in this, because so that Kush job, what was it?
I was a pharmaceutical sales rep, man. A
pharmaceutical sales rep.
A drug dealer.
Like,
okay, technically, that's a drug dealer. No, where I come from.
I always say, like, have you seen that movie, Love and Other Drugs, with Jake Gyllenhaal?
Well, I know the rest of this because I heard a previous interview.
Oh, okay, yeah. I hate to be repetitive, and I don't want to say the same thing in every single interview, but it does lead up to how LA Street Art Gallery got started.
Okay.
Basically, you know, I basically was always a DJ since college, man. And then I had this job where I basically had to deliver drugs to different doctors, man. And it was in the Melrose area. And, you know, all the street art started popping up. So I started taking pictures of it. And I noticed that there was like no community, even though there was a bunch of these artists, right? There was like not really a hub where artists can kind of get together and talk. So we just started this page called LA Street Art Gallery on Facebook. And then
no one had the name.
I thought that was incredible when I first started listening to your podcast and I heard Teachr mention that in one of the conversations that LA Street Gallery was just there for the taking.
Exactly. I was just like, wait, it's here for the taking? And the whole thing is like, there's a movement and LA is like one of the hubs. Like, what the fuck, you know? And then So at that point in time, I was like, you know what? Honestly, for being a pharmaceutical rep, it's a nice cush job for like a housewife, man. Like, you know, you go in, you drop off.
Calling yourself a housewife?
Oh, well, that's why I had to get out of there, man. Like, straight up, my job.
We all have dreams.
Yeah, I mean, I had to cater lunches for like doctors' offices, get to know the front desk ladies, you know, chat it up with them, and then so you can get like 2 minutes in the hallway with the doctor, basically. And then all you're saying is like, my drug, I was selling a high blood pressure medication called a Darby and also some acid reflux. Nothing fun, you know, nothing fun, right? Like boner pills.
No blue pills for you.
No Adderall, no boner pills or anything like that. You know what I mean? Nothing like that. But, you know, you can stand in the hallway and basically you're just like, hey, doctor, what's up? My drug's named this. You're kind of just reminding them to prescribe, right? So to be honest, I understood the system. At that time, I was like, man, I hear that healthcare –
you give them a little bit for free, you know, here's some little tasters.
Well, also, I heard that healthcare costs was like going up all the time. And I'm like, dude, I'm just sitting here like literally doing nothing every single day but catering lunches and like saying hi to the doctor and saying my drug name. I just felt really useless, you know, and I realized I was like, man, like I thought like if you have the money and you have like a nice job and you can kind of relax, like you'd be happy, right? You know, but I wasn't happy because at nighttime I was moonlighting still as a DJ, you know, and I just DJ at clubs and stuff like that. And I'd sunk all my passion into that. And I would just do this mindless job of delivering drugs every single day to the doctors. And my highlight was taking pictures of street art along the way of different offices, basically, you know? So it kind of leads into the story of how I met Teachr, actually. So during that period of time, we kind of chose a few artists.
He's like one incident away from being a serial killer. I'm kidding.
Hey, you are.
And then so at that time, you know, we picked a few artists that I felt like had some pretty like good messages out there and I feel like would be in the scene for a long time, because you know, people jump in and out of street art all the time. They think of a sticker and they're like, oh, I'm going to be the fucking greatest. I'm going to be Shepherd Fairey, man. This digger is going to be the shit. You know what I mean? And, you know, they do one run, they do it all, and then they give it to their friends, and then they kind of fall off. You know what I mean? Yeah. We all know those people, right?
Yeah.
So we picked a few artists and kind of just followed them along, and it's almost been 10 years now since we've been doing that. And, you know, it's just great to still have these artists.
It has been 10 years. It's 2021, dude.
Well, actually, officially, it's going to be March, actually, that we started this whole thing. You know what I mean? So it hasn't yet, but very close, you know. If it wasn't for the pandemic.
Next month, excuse me. Fuck you.
I'm sure we'd be throwing some, you know, party of some sort to kind of, like, gather everybody, because we have
no.
Yeah, we can't do that though, because we're not in California. Yet. Yeah, so I mean, the thing is, like, you know, for my music stuff, man, I've always kind of just like worked on it on the side as well too. And after I quit my pharmaceutical job, you know, I just started working on LA Street Art Gallery and music, man. Teachr just put on a mask of some sort.
Yeah, we don't have a video component at the moment.
I'm COVID safe now. You guys can do whatever you want.
Well, if you're listening to this podcast, you can go to our YouTube page, youtube.com/LHDartGallery, and you can check out this episode on video, man, because you know, you can also check out some of the old videos that we've had on there from like 10 years ago. Like, you can check out the video of when we first interviewed Teachr. This guy was a young man, dude. You know what I mean? He had like children.
Fuck you, dude.
Yeah, all of a sudden it's like, dude, you could just watch him.
Okay.
Like,
so I had more hair. I did have more hair. Okay.
You know what I mean? So, we always joke about that.
A lot less gray. Too.
Yeah, man. That's, I mean, true. At the end of the day, I just felt like,
hey, some of my hair just fell off then. Look at that. See, it just,
nice haircut, by the way. You didn't keep the fucking mullet.
No, dude, no.
So James, I guess to close up the part of you DJing, you're still currently DJing though.
Yeah. I mean, okay. I'm from California. I'm from Los Angeles. I'm born, Monterey Park, San Gabriel Valley. If you know the local neighborhoods, man. And you know, the thing about LA is everybody, at least before, everybody comes here for like, oh, I'm trying to make it, you know, I want to make it as a DJ, I want to make it as an artist, I want to make it as a music producer or something like that. And actually, there's like a lot of talented people here locally too, and sometimes we just kind of like do the local LA scene, man. And okay. The cool thing about street art is that it allows us to connect with people like you guys on the East Coast. It allows us to go to Europe and then immediately have like friends, you know, it's like a brotherhood of people, man. And you know, it's of artists and creatives. So it's just like, I found myself that, you know, I don't really understand how the music industry works, to be honest. You know what I mean? Maybe I'm not like good looking enough or something. Maybe I'm, you know what I mean? Maybe I need to actually be from fucking Asia and be imported into the music industry. But you know, I'm plugging away at, you know, working on music all the time. And you know, I've been working, I used to like work for a pretty well-known UK DJ as a producer as well too. Okay. For their radio show. So like I said, I've just been all around creative. And the reason I quit my quote-unquote cush job, man, is because, you know, I just want to tell people, it's like, if you're slaving away at your mindless job, man, and just for a paycheck, man, you're a fucking whore, dude. So quit that shit and do what you're passionate about, you know.
Unless you have kids and you need to support, then
it's different.
Hold it in.
Don't have kids.
Yeah, if you don't have kids, go for it. Seriously, if you don't have anything holding you back but yourself, then if you had some dreams and aspirations, go for them. Definitely.
Are you guys married? But are you guys married?
Oh yeah, I'm married. Yeah, with a kid. Yeah. Oh, okay. But I'm not married to Jay though.
No, we're not married to each other.
That's kind of what I was like, dude.
Okay, no, you know what? It's funny, man. It's funny. No. I'm like,
didn't strike me that way at all.
He's a great guy. He's, but not
great. Yeah,
no, well,
we're married to opposite people.
I'm actually in the minority, I guess. Then, like, you know, I almost got married one time, man. But you know,
I was the missile.
But the cool thing is, like, you know what? Like, I didn't, and I have happiness and time.
There you go.
Like, to like do shit. So, Anyways, the pandemic has been pretty chill for me. You know what I mean? Just like I social distance and isolate myself anyways because I'm not married.
Oh, you know what? The podcast has been really kind of a savior during the pandemic as far as giving us, you know, not only something to do, but just outreach and talking to other people and stuff. We kind of obsessed on it and did like, I don't know, was it 3 or 4 times the number of podcasts during the day of COVID? What are you doing? Nothing. Okay, want to do another? Okay, you want to do another one? Okay, let's do another one.
Yeah, we used to get together on the weekends or like, you know, if we, you know, have some time. And the thing is like, the good thing about the pandemic is that most people aren't doing anything nowadays, right?
Yeah.
And it doesn't take too much out of their time to do like an hour Zoom conference. And thing is like, actually it's like we did like triple the amount of episodes we did the first 2 seasons in the third season because there's just so much time. We already had a built-in audience before the pandemic started, you know, to start to listen. So a lot of people wanted to come on. So we're just like, hey, we got time, you know, to come on. So we kind of limited it to 2 a week that we were doing when we would sometimes only do 2 a month before, you know. So
right.
The cool thing.
And you know what? This is like a therapeutic thing for us.
Yeah, it is.
You know what I mean? Like you wonder like why do guys do podcasts like this? And you know, if we don't have like big sponsors right away, how do we keep going with it or whatever? It's because it's like a neuroplasticity type of a thing. You know, we enjoy having conversations and giving people an opportunity to get to know artists in a different way and in a different medium. And when you do something like that for somebody and you're not expecting anything at all in return, man, it's just like a, not only a mental, but a physical well-being that comes with it as well. And I told James, I'm like, dude, I don't care, you know, what the fuck happens with, you know, if we get a huge sponsors or whatever, I can do this till the day I die. You know, like, when, maybe not till the day I die. When I get old and shit, people are like, dude, you're fucking up. You got the dementia's really fucking with the whole show, okay? You, like, repeat yourself 3 times, and it doesn't work anymore, okay? Just need you, okay?
You know.
When James first asked me, it was, you know, years ago. And I, you know, remember, yeah, I'd like to do that. That'd be good, you know? And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, man, I ain't got fucking time to do that. I don't know. And then and also, the other thing that was in the back of my mind was I remember at that time he had asked me, I had done a podcast not long before, and it was, you know, about an hour long, 45 minutes or something like that. And I just remember I had said like a ton. I told a bunch of stories and everything, and then I glanced over, and it had only been 10 minutes. And I was like, dude, how are we going to fill an hour, like night after, well, you know, like show after show after show?
You missed one part, Teach. Like a lot of times Teach would have art shows and he would ask me, hey, I need a DJ to kind of like DJ the art show. Can you just come by and like kind of like be some sort of entertainment for people when people come in and things like that, right? So I had done that for him for 2 shows. And then whenever like I would have the show with him, I was like, oh, dude, like Teach, I love his art. We always have great conversation, actually. And then sometimes I chat with him on the phone about the setup of the art show. And then we would kind of get carried away and talking about random shit. And then I was like, dude, I can definitely do a podcast with this guy. I was looking for somebody to do a podcast with. And Matt, believe it or not, I actually had the idea of doing the podcast back in 2011 when we started. But the thing is, like, we had to resort to interviews, actually, because, I mean, people don't really want to talk to you for an hour.
Yeah, right? It's not easy. Exactly, an open door policy. Like, right. Oh, why are you on? Okay, here I come.
And people, yeah, yeah.
Especially if they don't know who you are, right? You know what I mean? After like 10 years, people establish, okay, like LA Strike Gallery, we know them. We know they're not cops. We know their what their motivation is, right?
We know that fucking asshole Teachr got arrested, so he's all right.
Exactly. And thing is, like, you know, for us, and talking about sponsors and things like that, we actually want to bring this up because we actually have a new paint line coming out. It's called Ghost Spray Paint. Okay. And the thing is, like, it's actually, you turn this around and it's the OG spray paint. Okay.
There you go.
Right. And it's actually made by, Seymour Spray Paint, which is actually the inventor of spray paint. Edward Seymour. He's actually the OG inventor of spray paint in 1947, actually. So before you got to think about this, before that, there was no like spray paint going on. You know what I mean? People were just like maybe like drawing on the wall with paintbrush, right? Technology didn't really allow that. So we actually went to the original
founder of Spray Paint, which is one of my customers actually, and then they did
literally the OG.
And they did a private label for us. So follow Go Spray Paint on Instagram, and then you'll we're gonna be giving out some cans and having some events and things like that.
James, when is that
hitting? Hey, what were they spray painting in 1947? Like the side of malt shops? Like what were they?
You know, actually,
everything, anything and everything that can be sprayed.
You know about, do you know about, Foo? I mean, Foo is here.
I yeah. only knew about it from you guys talking about it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let me bring it up too. Basically in the trenches. Okay. Of, during the World War, Australians basically, dude, you gotta let me share the screen or else I won't be able to bring it up.
Jay,
can we do that?
Give me a second. I got you.
If anyone listening on a podcast, we'll figure out it. Like James the teacher said, whatever you can't see in the podcast, head over to their YouTube channel and you'll be able to catch it.
YouTube.com.
I didn't
list your art gallery.
I totally forgot this was gonna be on YouTube. I didn't even. I would have got my makeup done. I would have cleaned up.
No worries.
Well, I combed your beard. Dude, you look fine. You look great. I got beard in me.
Oh, there it
is. I try to grow a beard like that. I look, you know, like fucking Deliverance.
There's two images that are kind of like the original graffiti images. Boo was here or Kilroy was here, basically. I'm sure you guys have kind of seen
it. Yeah, we know those.
I've seen it before. Yeah.
This is happening, you know, post-war, maybe a Korean War and things like that. Or there's Australian graffiti. Sometimes it says World War One. I'm like, I don't know about that because spray paint wasn't even invented then. But they could have been drawing it on the walls. You know.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Right. So it's just a pretty interesting story. And for us, man, I just feel like me as a DJ, I've always just loved underground culture, man. I go to underground raves. I DJ underground raves. That's where I feel at home, man. I want to go into a fucking shady ass area with graffiti on the wall and then find a dope ass party like where I find
do some seedy things.
You know,
yeah, it's very very European. Well, like, no, going into places in Europe, they're kind of like that. They're very,
that's true. But I have been to places in Brooklyn too, man. Gone to some dope ass like raves in you know, Brooklyn, New York, and things like that, man. And the vibe there is just super cool, man. I love like. Mm-hmm. When you go to raves in New York, people are always up with their fashion, man. Like, you know what I mean? You know, like for West Coast people, man, I feel like everybody's just there in like jeans and t-shirt. But, you know, in New York, sometimes it's cold outside. You got to get your nice jackets on. You got to get your kicks, boots on. You know what I mean? So, like, just go there and check out some cool New York fashion sometimes, too.
That's actually a perfect segue. Thank you for that. I feel like I paid you to do that.
Professionals here.
Because you know, every episode that we do here has a name, and the name of this episode we decided was West Coast. We like to focus on a different topic, and obviously, where with you guys coming from the West Coast, it was a no-brainer, right? So, what we wanted to really do was explore the effect the region on art forms. So, James, I guess you can start. Can you tell us what Cali has done for you and your career? Like, how's you know, what's the effect?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm born here, man. So first of all, it's home, you know, and second of all, I always see it like this, like New York, it's a walking city, you know, LA, it's like so much more massive because we got to drive in terms of like longer distances, you know, and then I always just feel like all these like LA streets, man, there's just like so much cool culture going on. You know, it's LA is inspired by the streets. If you think about it, you know, just the West Coast hip hop, man. You know, before that, the LA sound in the 80s was the Sunset Strip, man. Okay, we're talking hair metal, and before that, in the 70s, it was like the Eagles were the LA sound, you know, and then before that was surf rock. So it wasn't until like the late 80s and the 90s, and because of all the rioting and all the kind of bullshit going on in the inner cities, man, that hip hop and this gangster flavor just overtook Los Angeles, man. So it seeps into everything that we do. It comes into our music. It goes into our graffiti. It goes into the way we dress, man. And it's just very inspired by kind of like hood culture, man. So for Cali, for me, it's just like, I know, you know, I grew up here, and you know, I know the neighborhoods that I'm familiar with, and there's just different boroughs. It's very segregated, you know, so we get kind of like a spectrum of the entire world, just like you guys do get in New York, but we are a little bit more segregated. You can't just walk down the streets of Chinatown to get some good Chinese food. You might have to drive like fucking 45 minutes in traffic. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, anytime I've been to LA, it's like, oh, that's only, you know, 5 miles away, and it takes like 30 minutes. Oh, that's only 3 blocks away. It takes 30 minutes. Like,
can I ask you what
bro? I think I got stuck in traffic one time during an award show, and I think that was the worst. I was in traffic for like 2.5 hours.
Oof. You know, the thing is, like, most people, when they come to visit LA, if you know about LA, I mean, you probably – only go past a certain freeway, like a 110 or something like that. But actually, all the people who are transplants, they move like closer to downtown. All the people that grew up and that considers themselves LA, that goes all the way like an hour east of central downtown LA, and people will still say, "I'm from LA." You know, even if they're even if they're from like San Bernardino sometimes, which is Riverside County, which is closer to the desert already. If they're somewhere else in the world, if they're from New York, they ask where you're from, they'll probably say LA, you know,
right.
Just because it's closer, you know. So can I ask you guys, what boroughs are you from?
I'm originally from Manhattan.
Oh, okay. West side of Manhattan. Nice. Okay.
Yeah, not me. I'm always been a suburbs boy. I grew up on Long Island, so I've never actually lived in New York City.
Okay, dude, I feel like
People from Long Island, those are the ones when they go other places, they go, yeah, I'm from New York City.
Never.
That's the same exact thing.
It's the same thing. It's the same thing.
It's the same thing. Yeah.
Like, those are desert people.
For us. I like that. For us, it's kind of like it's LA County, right? I don't know how your counties work, but like Los Angeles County pretty much goes like, I would say, an hour east of the coast. I mean, sorry, an hour east into the coast. You know, you'll still be part of LA County. So, I mean, you technically are still from LA, right? So there you go. Like, how are there counties? Like, it's different counties in Long Island.
Outside of New York City. So outside of New York City, it's all counties. Yeah. So like on Long Island, it's Nassau County and Suffolk County.
Okay.
So I live in Nassau County. But yeah, the boroughs are their own, their own independence. And then once you leave, then you get to Westchester is a county, and then so on and so forth. Like, we build up out into state.
Is it true that people like kind of like they go to New York City to start working, and then when they want to have families, they settle down in Long Island? At least that's what I learned from friends, man. I'm just saying.
No, I moved to Jersey. I didn't go in that direction.
I think that's an old thing, but not wrong. Probably, but an older mindset though, like from generations past.
Okay.
I see. For the most part, most people will, you know, if they move to the city or they're from the city, be here in their 20s, maybe part of their 30s. But once you start a family, there's a large segregation that'll move outside of the city. Or if you have money in your pocket, a lot of them, you'll see them gravitate toward, you know, the wealthier areas of Brooklyn now and things like that. So Brooklyn's become a very like young hipster family.
What about like upstate, man? Do you like, how do the city people view, is it the same as like the Long Island people? Like, or upstate New York is like a little bit different.
So well, everything past the Bronx is Canada. So anything that's Canada.
So I think what happens is it takes a while. It's like a gradual experience for you to leave that city mindset. So going up into Yonkers, going up into Westchester, but then upstate New York and West New York they consider themselves two different things as well. So I don't say upstate New York. I mean, you know, I guess towards the playoffs, we all became Bills fans because it was our last hope. You know what I mean? So everybody's trying to hold on to something New York.
Are you guys football fans?
Yeah.
Okay. Like, you know, I'm a casual fan, man. My team is the Raiders, man. They were here when I was a kid, but you know, they're coming back. You know, we got that new stadium in New York. It's going to be cool. But how you guys feel about the Super Bowl, man? I mean, you guys got new picks?
I'm a 49ers fan, so.
Okay. Hey, like, you know what? When I was a kid, I loved watching Joe Montana play, too. So
yeah, of course. I have a soft spot
for the Niners, even though I'm a Raider fan, you know. Like, I'll go to a Niner game, man. But I before, in the black hole, man, I won't go to the black hole, man, to go to a Raider game.
Fuck that. Well, I'm a 49ers fan, and I'm a whatever team is playing against Tom Brady fan. So. That's where I am for the Super Bowl.
I guess we know who he's going for. I think the Super Bowl is going to be awesome. I definitely have this argument all the time that sometimes the conference championships are better than the Super Bowl because by the time those two teams meet, it may not be the best from both conferences. But this one in particular, I think we're going to see something epic. So I'm ready for it.
Well, check this out, man. I always say, like, you know, Tom Brady, man. People always say, like, ah, dude, that guy fucking has everything in life. That guy's dating Giselle. He fucking has, like, 6 Super Bowl rings, man. When does this guy fucking have enough, right? You know what I mean? But people
– he's a genetic freak. People don't understand that.
How do you feel
genetics...
about it, Teach? How do you feel about Tom Brady? I'm just curious. Like,
we never talk. I'm stoked, man. I think he's inspiring a lot of, you know, guys that are getting concerned and getting old, not able to produce much anymore, you know? I mean, fucking A, man. You go from a number one team to the absolute last team.
Worst team.
And bring him into the fucking Super Bowl. You can't really go much further, higher, you know, than that. So, but he's saying that he's okay with playing past 45, from what I understand. So
he didn't say that.
Wait till he gets to be my age. Okay, let's see how he's walking around. Let's see how them. But you know what? By that time, they could have some kind of stem cell research injection thing or whatever.
The CRISPR,
that you
gets, man.
Like a brand new knee or hip or whatever. Like, there we go. I'm 55, man.
He's going to have cyborg legs like Darth Maul. He'll be out there playing.
I like that.
He's good. He's obviously, he's a great fucking quarterback. He's not going out past his time. You know what I mean? They're not people saying, hey, man, look, like your team is like, you know, you're not dead last, but you're not. I mean, he's fucking number one. So as long as you're close to number one and you dig doing it, fucking go for it, man. Just be ready. Just be ready for that either handful of fucking pain pills or CBDs or whatever you're going to be doing because the pain is coming. Pain
the
is
thing
coming
about Tom
at some
Brady
point.
That I always respected, man, is people always feel like this guy is like, he has everything in life. But think about this, man. When he got drafted, he was like a 6th-round draft pick, dude. That guy was sitting on the fucking bench like, fuck, nobody wants me. God damn it. Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, you know, and that's why I, like, you know, like,
he did so well. He got pissed off. He's like, I'm going to show you, motherfucker.
You know what
6th round? Yeah.
To me, that's like a comeback story if you look at it from that point of view. You know what I mean? He hasn't, and, you know, for myself, like I went through puberty pretty late, man. So I was always like a catch-up guy. You know what I mean? I was like the smallest fucking guy. All my friends are fucking taller than me, dude. You know what I mean? And so like I understand, like, first of all, being picked last and shit like that, you know. And second of all, it's just like coming back from the behind and then like kind of like working your way, because at the end of the day, it's a long journey, right? And you know, so I do respect him about that, but goddamn, dude, he's very hateable. You know what I mean? It's like, but go ahead.
And he doesn't care if you hate him. I mean, come on.
No, he doesn't give a shit.
Oh yeah, I love that video of him and Gronk, man. The second video, dude. That they redid the P. Diddy Bad Boys for Life thing. I was like, I had that face just stuck in my fucking head. I was like, this motherfucker, dude. But what can you say, man? What can you say? You know what I mean? But
all right, let's come back around here, Teachr.
But yeah, let's circle. But I don't know how we got to Tom Brady, and I'm going to have to re-listen to this episode to figure out how we got that far down the rabbit hole.
Sorry.
But no. It's amazing.
Going,
like, it's organic conversation.
Something else now? Anything else?
No, but
we're going to. No, but
Teach, let's circle back on. Let's circle back on you then. And why don't you kind of dive in, and maybe we'll end up on LeBron. Why don't you dive in and tell us how, you know, the West Coast has influenced your art?
The West Coast kicked me in the balls really hard. And then when I was bent over holding my nuts, it fucking put its full foot right up into my ass as far as art goes. Like, you know, I thought I was some kind of shit. And actually, art and volleyball started with volleyball. That was the first humbling. Like, I was some kind of shit in Florida, you know, because I'm 6'3", and I can jump pretty fucking high for a white guy. And I was pretty good in Florida, you know, and thought I was going to come out here to California, maybe take a year or so to get my AAA, you know, and start picking up some partners, start playing some professional two-man beach volleyball. Man. Just to give you a quick story, to give you an example of how humbling it started, was like my first time playing down at the Santa Monica Pier. Okay. It's the only area where you can come and sign up and play. Otherwise you have to know somebody, you have to be, you know, going down there with someone, you know, reserved courts and shit. So anyone can go there. My friend of mine showed me there. I go, I sign up, wait my fucking turn. Everyone's taking forever because it's a fucking West Coast. where I came from, you play games to 11, next game's ready to go, boom, boom, boom. Here, games to 15, then they start warming up for the next game. It's like, come on. I pick up some dude, little muscle guy, and, you know, he's pretty good, and I'm like thinking, okay, I'm watching the other guys. I'm like, okay. Tell him, like, look, man, let's take it easy. First game was against a couple of old guys. One guy was 73 years old, and the other guy was 58. Okay, at the time, I'm 30 years old, 31 maybe. And I remember telling my buddy, hey, dude, let's take it easy. You know, let's not get spend too much energy this game because, you know, if you win, you hold court. You know, I wanted to hold court for a little while, get some good games in. Yeah. Well, little did I know that that was Bobby Barber and Al Luber, who are in the California Beach Volleyball Hall of Fame for winning the most games together. Okay. Little bitty guys. You know, here I'm this big hulking dude with a high jump and I'm bouncing the ball out of the, you know, off the sand and everything. And they whipped us 15-6. And and the game was over before I even realized what the fuck was going on. I remember I had Chuck gave me a beautiful set. I went up and I was going to just bury the ball. And the old man was right where I was going to be burying. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to be known as the guy that, you know, hurt the old man. There he is, Bobby Barber.
That guy.
And that's it. And so I tried to shoot it over his head. And he sticks his little knuckle up and goes, dink, and goes, ah, and pops the ball straight up. He's running over to the net, and his partner gives him this little low set. You know, it's not high or anything. And I'm thinking, okay, he's probably just going to barely go over the net here. And he goes, that same little knuckle, he goes, doink, and pops that thing right over my head. It's this close to the back line. I'm 15 feet away diving. I'm like, you know, okay. All right, so I'm going to – next pass that I got, and he was in my line of fire. I'm like, okay, I'm going to knock him down at least. I'm not going to kill him, but I'm going to, you know, put some mustard on this thing and just boom. And it looked like he was waving hi to somebody walking by, just this very smooth dig, over, you know, overhead dig like this. That ball was just barreling down all his face. He goes, poof, and the same height as when he knuckled that thing, and he took that same little run, and they were giggling the whole fucking time because they're out there, you know, here's this big killing the fucking ball, and they're just running around going, ew, ha, making a shot right over there in the corner. You're going to tuck it right back over here. No, I'm going to put a ray out in the deep corner now. And, you know, same thing with this. You know, I'm like, oh, I'm going to cover my back line, motherfucker. You know, I'm going to stand right in the middle this time. And this time he gets that same little knuckle up there and just barely touches it, and it drops straight fucking down on our side. Next one I got, I wailed on it harder than I could ever hit. It hit that far out. Next thing I know, the game was over. And I'm like thinking, man, fuck this, you know, professional two-man volleyball beach shit. This 73-year-old man and 58-year-old man just cleaned my fucking clock. You know, afterwards he comes over and he's like, hey, you know, you're pretty good. You know, you should work out with my son. You know, he's a pretty good coach. I'm like, yeah, whatever, old man, go fuck yourself. But I mean, that's what I didn't say that. That's what I was thinking. Right. And I ended up meeting his son finally, who actually is one of the top volleyball coaches in the fucking world. Like all the big two-man beach volleyball players you can ever think of. I remember going over to his place the first time. I walk in, he's like, I'll be out in a minute. And then I looked up on the wall. I'm like, oh, fuck. And okay, wow, he's the best. And here I am. His dad beat me. No wonder he beat me, because his son's the fucking, everyone's the best out here. And I never could get a good partner. So luckily, I say luckily because if I would have been better at volleyball, my body would have been a wreck. Mm. It's already a little bit of a wreck now because of like 25 years on and off of playing volleyball. But art, as far as art goes, you know, it was the same thing. I came out here thinking, hey, you know, I'm going to go an artist, you know, I'm going to go down to a gallery, give me a gallery. And they're like, who are you? Mm-hmm. Mm. Well, I see you're still living and we only work with dead artists. So that was one of the, I swear to God, one of the galleries, you know, it's like,
sounds
right. I'm sure they appreciate that. I'm sure those dead artists appreciate that, you know, fucking, you know, cunt.
You guys in New York probably have that, a lot of people too, like, going to the big city to make it as a XYZ.
Yeah.
Right. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, absolutely.
I'm just wondering, like, do you feel like the success, because here's the thing about New York. I feel like there is a culture of like, you can be a New York poet, and there's a history of
New York poets all the way like from the 1800s that's kind of like hung out in New York City, and you're kind of like living that life. So New York is in a sense of the world in that little small community, you know, but people come to LA and they try to make it in Hollywood. In Hollywood, it's like fucking brutal, obviously. And it's like a lot of people, you know, they end up like leaving. I'm just wondering, there's
dude, it's
like,
brutal in the streets also.
Well, yeah.
To finish up with that. So, you know, I come out here, try to get in some art galleries and like, you know, who the fuck are you? And so then I saw the graffiti and I'm like, man, I want to do something, but I couldn't think of anything. You know, and then in 2010, when they started making cuts in the education budget, my wife shows me the article in the newspaper, and I'm like, that's what I'm going to start doing. All kinds of images started coming up. And here's the funny part, you know, like there was a blog going along at the time called Merrill's in Fairfax, blogspot.com. And that's how I originally started becoming, you know, knowledgeable of other artists' work and everything. And the interesting thing about this was you could leave an anonymous comment, which doesn't sound like a big of a deal, but what it allows you to do is to just rip someone a new asshole about their work, and they don't even know who you are.
Right.
Which was the part where after I has been over and kicked in the balls with volleyball, here came the boot in the ass, straight up in my ass, is like, you know, I've been, you know, coddled and oh, you're such a good artist, you draw nice things, you know, all up until that point, and all of a sudden, here I see my artwork and some dude, you know, commenting down, what, this teacher needs to fucking learn a lesson about this, that, and the other. And I'm like going,
Well, that's the street art game, man. And especially during that period of time, like graffiti artists were way more hostile.
Vicious.
Towards, you know, like.
Vicious. Quote, well, they were given the forum. You open up, you put some artwork up there, and you allow people to say whatever the fuck they want without even having to let them people know who they are. But you know what, though? I finally, you know, got a thick skin, you know, calloused up and everything, and realized that, you know what, I actually got some good ideas from some of what these guys were giving me shit about, you know. When I'd see some people hating on my shit, I'm like, oh, you know what, that gives me an idea, because he's not seeing it the way I wanted to, and if I would have done this, then, oh, thank you, asshole. So when you can start looking at it like that, which is what I finally eventually did, then that's when you start becoming a man, or becoming a grown-up, I should say, or becoming a man, or being masculine, you know, racist, whatever. that's when you become a grown-up and about your artwork and about the whole situation, you know, because you start looking at, well, are you doing this because why? If you get someone upset, you know, what are you trying to accomplish, you know? And you start looking at things that way. And then it's like, well, if you're pissing some people off, you're at least getting across to somebody. You're making some people think. You know, so
I think to tie it all back together about how the West Coast basically has affected all of us is that there's just so many different elements of different cultures coming together in Los Angeles, just like New York. You know what I mean? There's like all these
proving ground, just like New York. It's a proving ground.
Yeah. And then I think that, you know, at the end of the day, what I was trying to say is like, whether it's like these, you know, gangster elements, whether it's the sunshine, whether it's just the street, you know, whether it's different artists coming together, you know, there are, LA is like kind of like known to be a laid back city, but I would say actually amongst artists is very like brutal and cutthroat too, you know, just like in New York.
Yeah, it can be. Oh yeah.
You know, and, go ahead.
I think, you know, LA, New York, Miami, I think one of the biggest issues with those places is that you're not just competing with people from those areas, right? You're competing with the world, because the world goes to those places to show their art, right? If you're
the world is watching.
Yeah, if you're in the middle of nowhere, you know, you could probably walk into a gallery and be like, I'm an artist, and they're like, oh, this is great, you're, there's 50 people in this town, we're gonna put your art up. But you go to LA, you go to Miami, you go to New York, these places, and it's like, well, you know, a lot of these galleries, they have waiting lists of artists from around the world that are waiting in a show. And they're like, well, your art is great, we can put you in for 2035. How does that sound?
The thing is, like, you know what?
And maybe you'll be dead by then and it'll be great.
Yeah, exactly.
The thing is, like,
try to die soon, okay? Try to die soon.
Getting that gallery spot, I mean, like, a lot of people feel like, oh, that's making it. Or, you know, doing a show at some place, like, you know, people think, oh, I'll feel legitimate after I do that, right? You know what I mean? A lot of people, like, think that way, man. And then you do the show, and then you're like, wait,
I didn't sell much money and I still feel the same way, but I did the show. How come I still don't feel legitimate? Like, you know, you, or for a DJ, like I played or I made this song and then a lot of people liked it. And like, you know, it got thousands of fucking views. You know, I always like to ask my creative friends, oh, when they tell me their plans, I'm like, okay. And then what? And then what?
Right.
And then what? Because right. You know what? Teach always teaches me. He's like, dude, as an artist, man, you don't get to retire, man. You know, you just, you, I mean, you can.
As an artist,
being a public artist.
Technically, you cannot retire. You don't right. retire as an artist until you're dead.
You know what I mean? So
that's when your career starts.
And then that's when your career starts. So yeah. Be yeah. prepared. Be prepared for that. If you're prepared for that, if you can take a full-on kick from David Beckham in right in the nutsack and get up and keep walking, you're good.
And David Beckham ain't even from L.A. Like that. It does something.
Yeah.
All right. So I have a we have a follow-up question. There's a few things here that we do want to get across to all the listeners, you know, because we do want them to take a listen to your podcast, but we have questions of our own. So you said podcasting picked up because of the pandemic. That's our same reason for even creating the podcast. How has then, I guess, location played a role in the building of your podcast? And I guess let me give an example of that in case I'm not clear, is that the internet gives us accessibility to everybody everywhere, right? And so have you, in the building of your community, has a podcast allowed you to stretch further than you planned?
Want to answer, Teach? Yeah. Basically, you know, we already have our, you know, Instagram pages, our YouTube channels, our Facebook pages, and every single artist have their own individual pages, right? Think about the podcast. It's like, hey, man, let's just take one of the most recent episodes we've done, Colette Miller, okay? She does the wings, you know, beautiful purple-pink wings. That
and now planets.
Yeah, and yeah, that's true, that everybody takes pictures in front of, right? How many Instagram models have you seen take a picture of it? You know, families take a picture, but nobody actually knows who did the fucking art. And it's like, dude, don't you think that somebody who's been around the world and done put these wings up at significant spots for a good message has some insight into life? You know what I mean? So that was our first interview. And it's like 120 something episodes later, we wanted to catch up with her too. And we're basically, that's the point of the podcast. Like, everybody just takes digital art, especially on Instagram, as disposable. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, that's cool, like it, okay. And then it made me happy for a split second, and then I just move on, you know? But the thing is, like, if you want to actually know about these artists' lives, and they all have very interesting lives, it takes a very special person to put shit up in the streets for 10 years. And, you know, my co-host is one of them, basically, too, you know? It's like, what's the motivation behind doing this? And also, it's just like, what keeps you going, you know? So the podcast really allows us to kind of expand on the artist's personalities instead of just letting their art speak for themselves. While some artists, right, Teach, they may not even want to come on the podcast, right?
Yeah, and it's a shame, because it seems like a lot of times it's these graffiti artists or street artists who have done amazing things, and some of them feel like they haven't done enough. And it's like, the door will always be open to everybody. You know what I mean? But we don't care if you're, you know, just getting started. You know what I mean? Like, we try to either find something interesting about who we're interviewing. We always do. And at the same time, help to educate them a little bit, as well as our audience. Okay. So...
Yeah, we talked to all sorts of people, man. I mean, we've talked to, like, for example,
we decided to open it up because, like, you know what? If we just keep it to, you know, street and graffiti artists, we're going to be limiting ourselves, you know. And you know, one of our reasons for doing this is to kind of educate people and open other people's eyes, because a lot of people don't even know to look for this shit. But once you show them, they can't not see it anymore. You know what I mean? So sometimes all it takes is just that one little thing. It's like, you know what? When you're in an intersection, you see that box over there, or you see that sign, look on the other side of it. Okay? I guarantee you, there's always stickers. There's something going on there, you know? And as soon as you let someone know, it's just that simple. now they know to look.
Is, you know, I started doing this, just taking a look at it when a lot of my friends, like, we didn't have a lot of, like, as much money or things to, you know, money to go do events. And you know what? You can make a day out of just walking down Melrose and, like, checking out the different street artists, man. You know what I mean? Like, talk, you know, maybe do some window shopping because you don't have any money. And that's what I love about street art, man, and public art. It's not just the murals, man. It's like, okay, you painted a big mural. Like, to me, that's actually less interesting than the guy that's fucking stuck a sticker, like, all the way across the country. I'm like, I want to talk to you. Like, why are you doing that, man? Like, everybody wants to paint on the big wall, right? Yeah. You know, get their big image on a wall, and then, you know, you can see it from a million miles away, right? But the thing is, like, the OGs of the OGs, like Trevor Ferry, they started off with a sticker, man. Like, I knew what Obey was before I even knew about what street art was, man. My, you know, because I would just see the Andre the Giant shit around. And by the time I actually found out about street art, I realized, I thought back on all the times I had seen that. And I was like, oh shit, was it that one dude, like, that was doing it the entire time, right? Mm-hmm. And I would say that you start to see, like, a ghost of the person actually slapping it up there or putting the stencil up there when you see their art, you know? And that's just something I want to share with people because, you know, people always say, like, oh, it's really specific, James, like, the type of art you like. I'm like, oh, actually, it's not. It's actually public for everybody, you know what I mean? You just have to kind of, like, take the time to understand the culture a little bit. And, you know, underground culture is always like that. It's like, why do people like to go raving? Why do people like, you know, underground hip hop that's not on the radio, right? You know, it has a deeper kind of, like, meaning to it than the just the general consumption of, oh, it's good. Let me, like, it's not fast food.
And also know that it's not all going to be great. There's going to be some shit out there, you know, but it doesn't mean you should stop or, you know, be judgmental. It's like, you know what? Find the art that appeals to you. Mm-hmm. I guarantee you it's out there somewhere.
Sure. I've also found that, you know, let me just finish.
No, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
The cool thing about street art is that, you know what, the community is, like, not, I would say, polluted enough yet where that there's, like, you know, corporate sponsors will try to come in and make it commercial. And then the thing is, like, whenever they try, it's always, like, just some, you know, not
they realize they're working with artists and artists
it's always watered down, you know. So the cool thing about I think about LA Street Art Gallery is, like, you know, it's the community of artists for the artist, and then, like, you know, we've always just done a good job at not really focusing on beef between the artists or anything like that, just being a documenter, man, because this art is temporary, you know. It's all it may only be up for a day, you know what I mean? Yeah. and then it gets buffed, right? So depending on what area you're in. So, you know, our LA Street Art Gallery has kind of been a hub for that. And it's a nice little platform to kind of launch other products that you guys, like podcasts, parties, paints, and things like that too. You know, we want to just keep it in the family of the people that, you know, like they understand the scene. Yeah.
Right. I, go ahead. Yeah, Jay.
No, I was just going to, I wanted to circle back on, I feel like, a lot of the things that you had just touched upon when you're talking about things like underground hip hop, these underground raves, street art. To me, the theme that kind of connects them all is this, the lack of a focus on commerce. How much do you feel that feeds into it? Right. Because, you know, you have these underground hip hop artists. Yep. They don't care about getting their song. Well, they care about getting their song on the radio, but it's not their end goal, right? Their end goal is to make really great music. Same thing with a street artist. Like, they're not going to get paid for the, you know, most of them are not going to get paid for a wall. But, you know, do you think that
that goes back to kind of what James was talking about earlier with how certain artists, they circle in and out, you know, like they come into the scene thinking, oh, you know, my shit's going to be great. You know, people are going to dig me. They're going to want to buy my shit. I'm going to be up in galleries. I'm going to be kicking ass and everything. And then when that doesn't happen, they kind of slowly, you know, drizzle out, you know. You know, when they can come in and, you know, somehow, you know, strike a nerve, then, you know, it's interesting to see what it does to them, you know, because you know, there's guys out there that will go and they'll find a spot that has never even been thought of touching before, and they'll do a piece and they won't even take a picture of it and they'll walk away. Those are the OG soul graffiti writers. You know what I mean? They like to find these spots that no one has ever done before. They put their piece up. A god, A-G-O-D, is the name that comes to mind. Virgin spots only is one of his hashtags. And that's inspiring to me that this guy is trying to make sure that he doesn't hit spots that have already been found and hit. And then a lot of times, it's not even him taking a picture of his shit. It's someone else that's taking a picture and has posted it. Right. So there's a therapeutic, side of it. But when it comes to the commerce side, the problem is, like I was saying a minute ago, you're dealing with a bunch of artists. And when you get corporate heads in and they're, trying to, okay, we'd like to have these six artists. We like these six artists, okay? And then, all of a sudden these six artists, a couple of them think that they're, better than the other artists. So they've spent more time, they've served more time or whatever. And so they want to make sure that they're receiving more money than, they want to make sure the money's right. And it's like, you hate to see that, but it's real. It's what happens sometimes.
Yeah. And that's why it's like, I feel like, understanding the artists and understanding the scene is like first and foremost of anything that you want to get into, it's kind of, Teach just reminded me of something real quick that just happened in the news recently. Did you guys hear about how six people got arrested because they tried to change the Hollywood sign into Hollywood?
Nah.
No.
Okay. Did not hear that.
So this just happened to me. Yeah, I saw that. I laughed and I was like, this is exactly what Teach is talking about. This is somebody new. Okay. They thought, boob. Let's change that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, no, they were saying that it was one of the guys that were with him or whatever was trying to say it was a, breast cancer awareness, stunt to help bring attention to breast cancer awareness, which is a clever thing to say, and they got away with just trespassing charges. That's it. Because they did not deface. They were just putting blankets up on it. So that's why they didn't get charged. So
going back to what I was saying, is that a lot of people dabble in street art real quick, just to kind of like make a statement a lot of times. But, the people that have been in for the long term, a lot of the artists that we interviewed, that's the ones that we really care about, man, because we want to understand why they are doing it and then come from a place that when we have events, when we have podcasts and things like that, we're not asking them stupid questions and things like that. I've worked with large companies, and actually I won't say the name of this one, but it's actually, they told me that Teachr wouldn't be a good candidate to actually give a tour give an explanation for street art because he's been arrested before. Now tell me, that's not understanding the culture at all, basically, right? You know what I mean?
Do you understand what it is that you want to learn?
you know what I mean? So to me, it's just,
and his name's Teachr.
Bigger brands, they'll come in and then, they always have some sort of design because they watch Exit Through the Gift Shop and they're like, we want to do this. We want a big wheat paste on the side of a building. They have an idea, but the thing is again, they're using the culture of street art for their own commerce. Like you said, Jay.
It's appropriation and it's all right.
I think the thing that makes it cool that you said is that connects all these underground cultures of artists. It doesn't matter if you're a musician, if you're a visual artist, if you're a dancer. I mean, we congregate at these underground places. It's dude, people aren't getting rich off these underground parties and things like that. There are, of course, underground rappers that make it, but they're not getting the radio play and the album sales that dude, rest in peace to a couple rappers I want to shout out. MF Doom just died recently. Double K from People From Under the Stairs died recently. Mm. Man, it's if you're just a casual hip hop fan, you've never heard of these people before, but it's the reason why there's so much love outpouring for MF Doom, man, is because his albums mean so much to the artists and the people who actually create a lot of this art, man. It touches people in a different way than, you can find me in the club, bottle full of bub kind of stuff. Yeah. not to say that that's not a great track.
Right.
Moment in time, right? Right place, right time, But normally when I'm listening to something that I want to feel thoughtful and it's in the rap genre, I'm listening to something in the underground genre, man. It's not some club stuff because I'm not in the club, so that was real insightful, Jay, and I agree with you.
I used to think I knew about music, and then for a while I was designing for undergroundhiphop.com, And I would have conversations with some of the people that work there. And I'm like, who? What? Huh? Like, what is it? What person? What? And I was like, I felt like I had just like learned about hip hop. I was like, yeah. I can't even have a conversation with you guys. Like,
and especially in New York, man. I mean, to be honest, like a lot of New York rappers, like, you know, I didn't hear about Big L until after like he passed, man, because, you know, on the when all that stuff was going on, we couldn't really hear Nas on the radio that much, you know, maybe one song with Lauryn Hill, you know what I mean? But we weren't getting played, like, you know, unless you were handed like a mixtape from your homie who knew hip hop, man.
Yeah, yeah.
You weren't gonna get like East Coast shit. Like, you know, I was on the Tupac army, man. I didn't like Biggie just because Tupac told me not to like Biggie. Yeah. You know what I mean? But the thing is, like, to be honest, it's just like I had only really heard Juicy play on the radio sometimes. It's like, dude, it's a great song, but it's just like the separation of East Coast and West Coast was like a lot more when we were younger. Like different markets for different stuff is like, it's real separated. And I'm sure that's how it is in the art scene too, and even more so in the graffiti scene. I don't see a lot of graffiti guys being able to necessarily have the funds to go out to the East Coast to do a tour unless you know they have some pretty good.
There are a few. Yeah, there are a few graffiti artists that, you know, I've seen over the ages, and then I'm wondering to myself, damn, do you have a sponsor, or how the fuck are you getting all over the world, getting up like crazy, and I don't ever see you doing any posts saying, you know, sold, thank you so much, grateful to sell this, or, you know, I've sold, whatever. It's like, hey, you know what, that just could be their thing, you know, like they don't feel like they need to make money off of it. And I know there are some graffiti artists that are like that. They just like to go put their stuff up and that's it. You know, like they like the nod, as they say. You know what I mean? They like getting the nod, which is just basically someone acknowledging them for what they're doing. So
I think it's a good thing. James, go ahead, finish that thought. And we have two things that we just want to wrap up with.
Oh, yeah. No, I was just saying that I think like, the recognition from your peers is something that I didn't learn was so important as an artist until, you know, at first you start doing whatever you're interested in because your ego, you think you're pretty good, right? You know what I mean? And then you're like, all right, I just want to express myself. You know what I mean? And then you get to a point where you've expressed yourself and then you actually need the recognition from your peers that you respect to actually feel legitimate as an artist, man, or else, like, you're just an amateur. So I was just saying that, like, that nod, actually, that Teachr's talking about is actually a lot of the reason for a lot of artists to continue, man. They don't necessarily do it for the money. They actually just do it. It's like, hey, man, I belong in this group, this community. I have respected peers, you know what I mean? So anyways, that's what I was going to say, yeah.
So we said his name, and I guess it's only right that we quote him. Nas said, props is a true thug's wife, right? So
I love that, man. Hey,
so
nice. But,
no, I was just wondering, like, you know, I always like to ask East Coast people, man, like any, like, which one of the West Coast rappers do you guys like feel, you know, do you guys like kind of like feel, man? Because like a lot of times.
Do you fuck with, as they say?
Yeah. Yeah. He teaches up with the lingo, you know, because a lot of times.
Check me out.
I got to say, man, like, you know, West Coast, like a lot of times in the 90s, man, like the lyricism and things like that work a little under par compared to a lot of the East Coast guys, you know, but we had a certain vibe, you know, like I said, that kind of like gangster lean, that, you know, fucking weed smoking, kind of like that, this whole thing, you know what I mean? So were there any West Coast rappers that like you guys kind of like tip your hat to when you growing up?
Like growing up?
Yeah, growing up.
Like, I feel like growing up, maybe I have a skewed thought back to it. I feel like I was exposed to, you know, West Coast music. I did like, you know, Tupac, and there was definitely kids in my class that liked Tupac, and it was weird because it was in the midst of the whole East Coast West Coast thing.
See, at first when Tupac came out here, we all know that he's from New York though.
Yeah,
he rapped like a New York person. All of a sudden he just came out here, and then it was like, what's funny is that on our podcast, actually one of the graffiti writers actually met Tupac when he first moved out to California, and he tells a really great story on it. It's the episode with Fish One, but you know, so it's like he first came out here. He was a New York rapper. His flow was very New York, man. I mean, if you look at like guys like Ice Cube, you know, and things like that, it's like they always Eazy-E. People always joke those were like kindergarten raps, man. Like, you know, the rhyme scheme, the flow. It wasn't as intricate
as a lot of like the East Coast guys, you know, I mean, they were doing like a different rhythm. Like Jay-Z was super choppy, you know, our guys were, you know, just kind of like rhyming on the beat, like old school style. But the thing is, mm-hmm. it was just the topics and things like that. So I guess I'm just saying, like, was Ice Cube, you know, like respected out there? Was Snoop Dogg respected out there? Because, like, a lot of times I feel like it was, you know, New York guys tell me different.
I don't know if it was a level of, I don't know if we can go to respect. I mean, to each their own. I don't think there was any, I don't remember anyone being like, you know, I don't respect those artists. I remember listening to Snoop, you know, when Snoop dropped that. I mean, you can't deny, like, when Snoop dropped music when we were younger, it was, it was like you had to vibe to it.
And I got a fucking story about Doggy Style, if I may, quickly.
Yeah.
That's the first time I got in trouble for drawing, because I started drawing all types of ass coming out of a doghouse because of the Doggy Style cover. My parents found that shit, and it got really weird in the house.
We got a story to top that story, actually. We had Joe Cool, who actually is Snoop Dogg's cousin, who drew that cover on our podcast as like the fourth episode, man. And you guys gotta go back and
boy, you talk about a boot camp of a fucking interview. Holy shit. James and I looked at each other at one point, we're just like,
ha. Now Crespo, you got a corner in the back behind you, right?
Yeah.
All right. There's a corner where the walls like meet each other, right?
Yeah, like right up there.
Joe Cool forever changed my mind on how to look at a corner, because he told me that when he was locked up in prison, he would see a corner and he would see two legs and a pussy, like right in the corner, basically.
So he'd draw hair up in there, like a
hair at the crack right there, so the gentleman in the prison would have something nice to look at, man. Okay, I'm just saying that.
That was shortly into the interview.
Wow.
It's like, okay, how do we segue to something
not safe for work after that?
Anything else? What do you got, James? Can you talk about some fucking, I don't know, man. That's
food. It's too late. It to food.
All right. It's too late.
Sorry.
All right, now I want to redirect. Quick. Hurry.
Good idea.
Since creating a podcast, have you seen or has it resulted in increased traffic into your individual endeavors?
Yeah. I'll go first. You know, I DJ shows and things like that, and I would say, like, the street art scene is adjacent to the music scene, you know, the underground rave scene, the party scene, right? So I've actually had graffiti artists, like, come to my shows without even knowing. They just say, hey, I listen to the podcast, man. I just want to come out to one of your shows. And I was, like, fucking blown away, man. I was just, shout out to Figure, man. I mean, like, you know, to me, it just shows, like, hey, man, you know, you start podcasts in the future as censorship gets more and more, man. It's just like, hey, you actually have your own voice to express yourself. And that's what I value. What about you, Teach? I mean, have you seen any, like, increase in followers or people, you know?
I don't really pay attention.
Okay.
But you know, what I have noticed is that it's developed a little bit closer relationship with the fans that I do have. Oh. People that actually put comments down and stuff and you know, that actually, you know, it's it seems like it's I guess it's basically another effort in the art world. I was telling James not long ago that another reason why I enjoy doing the podcast is because it makes me feel like I don't necessarily need to go out and get some artwork done, you know, to show that I've done something.
Yeah.
You know, because here I am, I'm doing something here by trying to help other artists, you know, and by doing that, I'm also helping myself because I'm putting myself in that position, creating legacy. But, you know, when we first got started, I never finished this. You know, I told James, you know, okay, sure, I'll give it a shot and everything, that I was kind of worried about filling up the content because of that one podcast I'd done and talked so much, it'd only been 10 fucking minutes. And so the first podcast we did was actually the night before my second solo art show. Mm-hmm. And James came by the gallery, and I was just going to spend the night in the gallery so I could have some peace and quiet, be away from the kids and the wife and everything. And, you know, he's really kind and considerate, you know, he goes, hey man, look, I know you told me, you know, we can do this, but, you know, I still, you still got a little bit of stuff to do. We can do this another night. I'm like, nah, dude, come on, let's, you know, in my mind, I'm going, let's go ahead and get this first one over with, because I don't know if I can do, you know, how this is going to go or whatever. And so we got started, you know, we just started chatting about how it all got started, and the guy that was doing the blog from the beginning or whatever. And it didn't really seem like long after that, that he was like, okay, man, that's an hour. And I was just like, what? I have so much more that I could have said and could have gone on for like hours. Yeah. And it was right at that point I knew, I'm like, dude, we can do this. We can absolutely fucking do this, because if just he and I can just easily, very easily just go on for an hour, we can easily do an hour with someone else. For sure. So,
and one of the things, like, I always feel too, is like, you know, like when the George Floyd incident happened, man, you know, we had a podcast that day actually, and all that shit hit. And then like we were just going to come on. Actually, we had a guest cancel on us because he felt like it was like insensitive to, I guess, do a podcast that day or something like that.
Okay.
So I was just like, okay, well, we're still going to do a podcast, man. So actually we allowed us to have the time to talk to each other about, sure, the situation, man. Like, it was such a fucked up situation, George Floyd, that it's like, dude, yeah, like everybody's kind of locked up in their own homes, and you know, nobody really has anybody to talk to about, and
no sounding board, no outlet at all.
Yeah, I felt like a lot of people reached out to us and said, hey, that was a great episode, man. We started that episode off with For What It's Worth by Buffalo Springfield. It's a classic rock song that they commonly played in the 60s. A protest song, you know, and then it was just like a lot of
something's
people said that,
happening here.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and that's it's just like it gave a lot of people the ability to commiserate with us. You know, it's just like, hey, it's not just me feeling that way. It's, you know, James and Teach, like they're just dudes, you know, true, like hanging out on the podcast, and they feel this way too. So, you know, that's what I've been listening to podcasts for, like, I don't know, over a decade. You know, and it's just like that's one of the things, like, I love about podcasts. Sometimes it's just like, if you don't have anybody to share your thoughts with, if you can listen to somebody else talk about it, it actually helps you expand your mind and palate on the what's going on too. So going back to your original question, like, how is the podcast like kind of like increased just our brands or yeah, our avenues, man? I mean, it just has increased me better. It helped me better as a person to, I guess, like, process my own feelings too, man, you know, and, you know, we have people that, fans or listeners, that can reach out to us, man. And I think, like, you know, it just like brings that like closeness to whoever you're talking to, 'cause these are people that listen to you every single week. And, you know, I have podcasts I listen to every single day.
Yeah.
And I literally depend on those podcasts to get through my day, you know, and I'm glad we can bring some happiness to people and make people laugh. And, also help out some artists, you know, jump on the platform and introduce themselves.
Right on. Right on. Jay.
All right. So if you guys have heard any of our episodes before, and if anyone else has heard our podcast before, we know we always end our shows the same way. It's a segment that we like to call copy, collab, erase. So what we're going to do, guys, is we're going to give you three names. You're going to choose who you would copy, who you would want to maybe copy their style, who you would love to collaborate with, and then one person has to go. So our three names today in our West Coast edition of the One Love Art Sessions are Dr. Dre, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, and Jack Nicholson.
That's good. Well, I mean, for me, it's like F, Murder, Kill, right? But
yes.
It's copy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's copy, collab.
And erase.
And erase. Yeah,
you don't have to fuck anybody.
Yeah.
I like that. All right, you want to go first, Peach? Because, like,
You said Jack Nicholson?
Yeah.
Correct.
He can go. He's too fucking old. You know what I mean? He's had his time. I appreciate him. I love him and everything. He's got to go. You know what I mean? He's fucking crazy now. So that leaves Ice Cube.
And Dre and the Peppers.
Dre and Red Hot. Well, I've already collaborated with one of the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Dave Navarro. So, we'll just go with collaborate on them. And sure, the Cube, I'll copy that motherfucker, badass motherfucker,
Dre. But
there you go. Dre, you, what's, it's,
don't say it. Don't finish that statement.
Yeah.
You know what? I hate to be so unoriginal, but like, you know, I would say, I would probably copy the Red Hot Chili Peppers more than I copy Dre. And I would, I would collab with Dre. And then, like I said, I respect Jack Nicholson for a lot of his older work, man. One Flew Over Cuckoo's Nest. I mean, it's like amazing movie, man. But, his new stuff.
Shining.
Yeah, exactly.
Not going to hurt you, Mindy.
Chinatown, right? I just watched
it. It's going to bash your brains.
That's a pretty good impression, Deech. But, you know, I think like, I respect the Red Hot Chili Peppers a lot, man, because, I mean, they're just a very L.A. band, man. And, at the end of the day, like, everybody's picked up a guitar and tried to play Under the Bridge before, right? Mm. You know what I mean? And
I haven't.
Well, if you tried.
Hey, plus, we interviewed Dave, so three times now, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, to me, like, the Red Hot Chili Peppers as a band, man, they just represent L.A. a lot, man. While Dre represents, like, Compton and everything like that. To me, like I said, I would love to collaborate with Dre one day, man. That would be great, but I don't know if it'll ever happen. I do hip-hop. I do mainly house music these days. Yeah. I've done all sorts of music, man, but at the end of the day, I think I just have a utmost respect for Red Hot Chili Peppers, just because they're definitely sealed in the rock history as one of the ultimate bands. You know, and
originals,
rock music is, I mean, kind of dead these days, man. I mean, like, what bands are coming up that aren't like Imagine Dragon sounding, dude? You know,
well, dude, everything's been fucking done. Same with the art world, you know what I mean? All it is just a combination of things that have already been done at this point,
yeah. Well, sampling each other, right?
Exactly, you know, and I think that
I'm not, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not trying to come off like that, but that's just all it is at this point. Everything's been done.
Hell yeah. I mean, you know, I think like that's a pretty good question though. I like those, man. And we should start having like segments like these on our show too, man. Like, be more professional, Peach. Like, for us,
gentlemen.
Yeah, for us, honestly, it's so awesome hanging out with you guys, man. I love the show. You guys got to come on our show too and kick it too. We got to ask you some of our questions, man.
But. Yeah, for sure, man. We'd love that. We love your podcast. Keep doing what you do. Thank you for making time for us. And we hope that we can continue to get your word out of your podcast, because you two guys are awesome. And your guests are incredible, and there's so much to learn. So anybody who is looking to just learn more about the craft, learn more about street art, learn more about the community that exists because of it, we're going to send them over your way. So thanks.
Oh, yeah, man. And
you have any artists, West Coast artists that want some East Coast exposure, you let us know.
Oh, yeah, just, yeah. We got
any up-and-coming artists, man, send them our way. We would love to chat it up with people we've never heard of before.
Sure. We're going to send you guys some spray paint too, guys.
No doubt, man.
Like, I'm with that.
Because, like, we're gonna kind of, what we're basically going to do is we're going to give every single one of our partners a code so you can actually earn per can that you're selling with too. You know what I mean? So we'll talk to you guys a little bit more about that off the air, man. But
yeah,
a lot of different things coming, man.
Well, whatever information you want us to distribute and share with our listeners as well, please feel free to send it over to us and we'll get that into everybody.
Dude, anyone that has been on any of our shows, you guys are interested in, let us know. We'll slide him a quick note for you. And
yeah, shout out to Chris, because he's been on both of our shows. RWK. You know.
Yeah. Actually,
oh yeah, Robots Will Kill.
Yeah, man. Badass. You know, congratulations, Chris, RWK, on his most recent Up magazine cover, man. It's super dope, and it's got an advertisement to Go Spray Paint inside that magazine. So follow us at Go Spray Paint on Instagram. And, follow us at PT Show on Instagram, and you'll find all that good stuff there. My music's there, Teachr's art is there, and like I said, all that good stuff.
Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
All right,
guys.
Hey, James, good luck with that little baby, man. Sending you lots of love and energy.
Thank you.
You're going to need the energy.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Yeah. I'm going to
try to sleep when you can.
Need coffee now.
Yeah.
Peace out,
folks. Take care,
guys. All right. Later, guys.
Thank you.
Peace.